welcome everybody. My name is Steve Abraham. I'm a Principal Database Specialist Solutions Architect with AWS. And today we're going to be getting started with Aurora database cloning. On our agenda, we're going to start with a brief introduction to Amazon Aurora, and then we're going to dive right into database cloning, and we'll wrap things up with a brief demo at the end. Amazon Aurora is designed as a high-throughput OLTP database engine. We measure the performance of Aurora based on query throughput. The Postgres-compatible edition of Aurora can provide roughly 3 times the throughput of standard Postgres, while the MySQL-compatible edition provides roughly 5 times the throughput of community MySQL. In addition to handling high throughput per instance, Aurora can scale up to 15 replicas within minutes, regardless of the size of the data volume. As we'll examine in the upcoming slides, Aurora maintains 6 copies of the data spread across 3 availability zones using a purpose-built storage layer. This storage layer is key to Aurora database cloning. So what we're looking at here is a representation of an Aurora cluster storage volume. You can see that the volume spans 3 availability zones, and within each availability zone, there are many individual storage nodes represented by the small squares. Each of these storage nodes is actually a multi-tenant EC2 instance with directly attached NVMe storage. When a write is performed within Aurora, the log records are sent to 6 storage nodes, 2 in each AZ. Once 4 of them acknowledge receipt, the write is considered durable and the log sequence number is incremented. Data in the Aurora's storage volume is segmented into what we call protection groups, which are 10 gigabyte chunks. When a cluster is created and the first bytes are written to the volume, there are 6 storage nodes. As the volume grows and reaches 10 gigabytes plus 1, 6 more storage nodes are allocated and on it goes. So if you take the total volume size and you divide it by 10 gigabytes and then multiply that number by 6, you'll know roughly how many storage nodes underpin a given volume. What this means in practice is that a sufficiently large storage volume may have hundreds or even thousands of storage nodes. So let's talk about database clones. I mean, as you can imagine, a clone is a copy of, you know, a storage volume here. And that's really what we're talking about with Aurora. You know, the storage volume, like we just looked at, is separated from the compute, which would be the instances. And so we're copying that storage volume. And so some of the common use cases, obviously testing changes in pre-prod on relevant data sets. So for example, you're about ready to, you want to see if an index is going to work, for example, on your production data set. Well, you don't want to do that in production. You would create a clone, add the index, run your query, test it out, see if it works. Maybe reorganizing a database with minimal impact. So what this looks like is essentially you create a clone, and let's say that you wanted to, you determined that that index that you just tested is in fact a good idea, but you don't really want to deploy that into production directly because it will be a blocking change, right? It's gonna prevent other queries from executing. So what you can do is create that clone, a new clone, add the index, and then use the CDC, you know, a bin log or, you know, whatever CDC to stream the changes from your primary cluster to the new cluster, and then do a failover, sort of a blue-green deployment. Another thing that you can use clones for, it's very common, is for reporting purposes. So, you know, you just grab sort of a snapshot in time of what the database looks like. You know, Aurora being designed as an OLTP database engine, it works the best with those short, quick, massively parallelized type transactions, right? If you're going to run long running analytical queries, you probably, no matter what engine you're using, don't want to run those mixed with your OLTP workload. So just creating this clone quickly allows you to run those types of queries without any impact to your OLTP workload. And then again, another thing that you can use it for is failback for maintenance activities. You know, a lot of people will create snapshots before they're about ready to undergo some major sort of maintenance activity. And there's nothing wrong with that. It's just that snapshots actually copy the data. And so they will take longer and they will also cost money for that, you know, additional storage. Whereas clones, regardless of the size of the volume, happen quickly and in consistent amount of time and don't cost any money, at least initially. As far as using clones, you can have up to 15 clones from the same source. It's a 2-step process. Like I was discussing earlier, you're going to clone the cluster, and then you're going to add additional instances. And we'll see that later in a demo. The clone will start with the same database engine version as the source, but you can upgrade it. In fact, that's another common use case, is upgrading, say, to the next major version. You might clone your original 5.7 compatible version as an example, and then upgrade the clone to the MySQL 8 compatible version, and then, you know, do the same thing that we discussed with the CDC between the two and do a failover for your upgrade. And last thing I want to mention on here is you can create cross-account clones with resource sharing. So let's take a look at clone operations and see what happens when we create a clone. What we're looking at here is we have an application, and it's in availability zone 1 and 2. You can see that the writer node is in AZ2. And in both cases, they're reading from this primary storage, that gray box near the bottom there. You can think of as the storage volume for that cluster. And they're both reading those data blocks off of the storage. But we have this new need. We need to add in a reporting application. And like I was just saying, we don't really want to run the reports on the application copy of the database, because it could, you know, interfere with our OLTP processing, right? So once we have decided we want this reporting application, we're going to go ahead and create a clone. And we'll just add, you know, a writer instance, a read-write, you know, instance to that. And you can see at the bottom, we now have this clone storage. So the clone storage, you can see, is separate and distinct from the primary storage at a logical level, right? So at a logical level, that reporting application clone is going to connect to the clone storage rather than the primary storage. But what happens is, initially, when that clone storage is created, we have a bunch of pointers that point back to the actual data blocks that are in the primary storage. And so when that reporting application wants to connect to the clone, and then it wants to read from that clone storage, it's going to connect to the clone storage itself. Remember, they're logically separated. And the clone storage is going to say, I have this pointer that points back to that individual data block that's in the primary storage, right? So that's where the data is going to come from. Now, let's say that the reporting application needs to modify one of these pages. So what are we going to do there? Well, what we're going to do is we're going to go ahead and copy that data block from the primary storage to the clone storage, and then we're going to delete that pointer. We're going to delete that link back to the primary storage. And this is when you start to actually build, you know, the data within the clone storage when you make those changes. And so we're not really paying for anything for clone storage until we start making changes like this. Now, what happens if we wanted to add new data to the clone storage? We're not just updating, we're going to do an insert, right? So that's just going to add new data blocks to the clone storage and has no effect at all on the primary storage. So what about when the application needs to make some changes, right? So if the application adds a new record, we just create new data blocks that are in the primary storage and again have no effect to the clone storage. But what if the application wants to modify a block like this one right here? It's going to be similar as to how the modifications go for the clone, except in reverse. What we're going to do is we're going to copy that block over to the clone. So the clone will have the correct version that corresponds with the state of the data on the clone. And then we'll delete that pointer. And then the data will be updated on the primary storage. So, you know, another thing that, you know, customers will often ask is, what about performance, right? Because after all, the clone is actually, at least initially, reading data from the same literal storage nodes as the original storage volume, right? Well, what we can see here is that we ran PGBench with a target of 20,000 transactions per second. And the blue line represents what would be, we'll say, our production database, right? And you can see that we're pretty steady at 20,000 transactions per second. And then right around the 39-minute mark, you can see the clone comes online. And not only does the clone still deliver the same transactions per second, but it also does not take away from what the primary database was doing from a performance perspective. And so, you know, part of the reason that we can do this, when we talked initially about the, you know, the potentially hundreds or thousands of these storage nodes, and we've got six copies of the data, is each one of these can pick, and we do actually identify what are the fastest storage nodes for any given protection group. And then we can go ahead and, you know, deliver the best performance there. So it really does not have any impact on your production database. So with that, let's go ahead and jump into a quick demo. So right here, we're in the RDS console, and we'll go ahead and click on databases. And you can see we've got three different clusters here, right? And we're gonna go ahead and drill on this S3 import cluster, because I think we've got some data in here, and that'll be a good candidate to create a clone. So in here, let's click on monitoring. And let's look and see how much data do we actually have on this volume. So we're going to look up volume bytes used, and you can see we've got about 3 terabytes worth of data in this particular cluster. So that's important to note. We're going to keep that in mind when we create our clone. So let's go to actions, then we'll create a clone. Now, when this comes up, we're going to go ahead and give it an instance identifier. This, through the console, is going to create both the instance and the cluster. And we can make changes here if we want to, but, you know, for our purposes today, we'll just leave all of the other defaults. You don't have to make any changes. You can just stick with the defaults and then just click on Create Clone. And you can see that our new cluster is creating. It's in the creating state. We'll refresh, and it looks like there we go. We are online with the new clone. We click on the cluster. Let's go to monitoring, and let's check the volume bytes used here on the clone. Now remember, we had 3 terabytes. We only have about 7 megabytes. So in summary, I just want to point out a few things. The first is that clones, you can create them very fast and in a very consistent amount of time. And this, again, is because we're not copying any data anywhere. We're simply creating that new cluster and then using the pointers to the data until you know, we start making changes. And so it's very useful for creating sort of that quick sort of snapshot view of the data. The other thing is that there's full isolation, right? So, you know, even though we're reading from the storage nodes initially, from a logical perspective, they're two completely separate and distinct clusters. And as we saw from the performance metrics, regardless of what the workload is, it's not going to interfere with either the clone or the source cluster. The third point I want to make is that it's inexpensive. Again, since we're not copying any data, we're only copying modified pages, you know, data blocks, it's very inexpensive. We use copy-on-write technology, right? And, you know, we saw in the slide where we were looking at the reporting application information how, you know, when we performed a write, when we modified one of those data blocks, we would just copy it over to the clone. So that, you know, but there's no reason to copy it until we've modified it. Reporting, again, a great use case here. You know, regardless of what type of database engine you use, it's never a good practice to combine both OLTP and reporting. And so creating these clones, I mean, you could create a clone every hour and have a new snapshot view of the data every hour as an example, if that's what you wanted to do. Blue-green deployments, again, very powerful for that. It's great for doing upgrades, you know, between versions of the database engine. It's also great for, you know, just any type of blocking changes. And then, of course, dev, test, and QA are also perfect candidates. Just want to thank you for your time today, and I encourage you to take a look at Aurora Clones.